welcome. This is the noisy crowd I know and love. It's nice to have you all here this morning. This is our rally kickoff Sunday for the fall as programs go back into their normal swing. We do have a baptism today. Welcome everyone, big crowd for the baptism. Nice to have you here. As we begin our worship this morning, get up here, Megan. Get a move on. As we begin our worship this morning, would you stand with us and sing? The words will be on the wall in front of you. Those who are regulars here know this song pretty well.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. All that This is Amazing Grace. This is a failing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
It's a great song. This song is based on an old hymn. In fact, it's the old hymn we'll be singing as we close our worship today. My hope is built on nothing else.
Jesus.
Cornerstone, we begin our worship today. Please remain standing, turn in your bulletins to the call to worship.
Please join me in the call to worship. Now you are no longer foreigners or aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household.
Built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone.
As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by men, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house.
To be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ.
For in Scripture it says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone.
And the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame."
Join me for the opening prayer. Almighty God, we worship this morning
standing upon the firm foundation of Jesus Christ our Lord. As the world shifts and slides in various directions, keep us ever in line with the true cornerstone. Guard our minds, guide our hearts, be exalted in our worship, be glorified in our lives, through Jesus Christ, our rock and our foundation. Amen.
Take a moment to greet one another as you are seated this morning. Good morning and welcome. It is so nice to have everyone here this morning. Welcome to those who are sort of drifting back in after summer. We are back up to full speed. Welcome, Wesley, and all your family and friends. Good grief. It's nice to have you all here this morning. And we are going to celebrate his life and commit him to the Lord in just a moment. Please note all of the stuff in your insert as we get back up to full speed with regular Sunday school and programs. There's a lot going on. I'm not going to highlight everything going on, but note there are lots of activities to connect and socialize, activities to grow, book studies, Bible studies, fellowship groups, all kinds of good stuff in here. What I want to highlight for you this morning are just two things. One, in our busy world, please note all these electronic ways to stay connected with your church, including electronic giving and services on YouTube. Those of you who saw the baptism this morning, Wesley will have his first YouTube video posted this morning. You know, how cool. And all these other ways to stay connected with your church. We know life is busy. We're trying to work with that. And the thing I want to most point out to you who are regulars here, but everyone's welcome to look along, is our mission statement. You're going to see this all month, as this is going to be my focus. Most of you who are regulars here know this. Draw in, grow up, and reach out. Draw into Christian community. Grow up through worship and discipleship. Reach out. Good words and good deeds, which you've just clarified a little bit, with charity and evangelism. On the back, as we've often done, are practical ways for you to engage in the mission statement. And notice something new on the bottom as we recommit ourselves, reconnect. That's our theme for this Sunday, to our church. There's a little grid on the bottom, sort of a little worksheet for each of you. What I'll do to help myself and to help others to draw in, grow up, or reach out. You can't do everything, but I challenge each of you as the year progresses, see what you can do. So what I mean by that is, we want to be a community, so what can you do to get in there and get to know people more? But we're also a community that helps other people do that. What can you do to help other people become more part of the community here? What can you do to grow in your relationship with God this year? What can you do to help other people grow in their relationship with God this year? What can you do to reach out to others? What can you do to facilitate opportunities for others to reach out? You get what I'm saying? So I challenge you, can't do everything, but think about this prayerfully and consider your part as a member of the church here and all these opportunities here. Which ones will you plug into to help you do your part in the mission? At the bottom it says, if we all do our part together, we can do great things. And in Christ, all things are possible. You're going to be hearing a lot about that over the next couple of months. This morning, we are privileged to have Wesley here. Let me just say, so Sarah, Mom, and Dad, Max, I was privileged to marry them, do their wedding. I know you're all focusing on how incredibly cool I look with those sunglasses, but focus on Max and Sarah, they're a beautiful couple, and now I'm privileged to be able to officiate and baptize their son, Wesley. So if I can have Mom and Dad and Wesley come forward. And they have set a new record and precedent for having the most number of godparents we've ever had in the history of our church. I'm officially calling them the God Squad. So if we can have parents and godparents come forward for the baptism. And if the rest of you could turn to this green insert. Dad, I'm going to just stand right here. Godparents all right over here. Stand right in the center of them. Come a little forward. And our lay leader, Steve McKinley, will be assisting me today. Read together with me. It was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, that I know very well. God, you are the designer and the giver of all life. Today we come to you with joyful and thankful hearts to celebrate the life of this little child in our midst. We come to offer back to you that which you have given us and to seek your care and your blessing.
People were bringing the little children to Jesus to have him touch them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them,
"Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." Sarah and Max, today you have brought your child, Wesley, here today, desiring for him Christian baptism. Baptism is a sacrament, an outward and visible sign of God's inward and invisible grace. It is a sign of God's blessing upon Wesley and a mark of his acceptance into the care of Christ and the church and the beginning of his growth into full Christian faith and discipleship. Baptism is a constant reminder that the gift of the gospel is not only for us, but also for our children. And Jesus took the children in his arms and blessed them. In our church and in our tradition, we believe that one connects themselves with God through faith. When a child is baptized, it is the faith of their parents that brings them into the church community, with the hope and prayers and hopefully upbringing that will lead him to make that own decision to put his faith in Jesus Christ at the appropriate age and in God's timing. So today, Wesley, who's pleasantly asleep, will probably not remember this, but you have brought yourselves here to dedicate yourselves to God on Wesley's behalf. And so as you brought Wesley here today, you have brought yourselves to commit yourself to God on Wesley's behalf. Sarah and Max, as Wesley's parents, do you promise with God's help to instruct Wesley in the Word of God, to show him the way of salvation, to teach him the principles of our Christian faith? Do you promise by your words and example to bring him up in the love and the fear of the Lord, to teach him to turn away from evil and to seek righteousness, justice, and peace? And do you promise to pray with him and for him and to bring him up in the fellowship of the Christian church? If so, would you please say, "We do." And to the God Squad over here, the godparents, Jamie, Hannah, Kevin, Elizabeth, and Jonathan, who's not here today, correct? In absentia, but he can watch on video. I'm holding you accountable too. As Wesley's godparents, do you promise, with God's help, to support and encourage Sarah and Max in fulfilling the covenant they've made this day? Do you promise, as you are able, to assist Wesley that he may indeed grow up in the love and the fear of the Lord? If so, would you please say, "We do."
And do you, the members of the First Congregational Church of Holden, along with those present who believe in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, commit yourselves to loving and caring for the little ones, like Wesley, in our midst, and assisting parents in fulfilling their covenant to raise their children in the love and fear of the Lord? If so, say, "We do."
We do.
And to the children here this morning, are you with me? We have a commitment too to little ones like Wesley to welcome him and to love him and to set a good example for him. So to all the children here of the First Congregational Church, if you're willing to do that, would you please say nice and loud, we do.
We do.
All together. Grant us, O Lord, the grace to perform that which we have promised before you this day. And bless with your spirit this child now to be baptized and committed in Christian faith to you. Amen. All right, Wesley, let's hope this is a good transition. Uh-oh. Good morning. Who is this strange guy? By what name do you call this child? Wesley James Noel Dottilly. I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of Jesus Christ the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. And I mark you with the sign of the cross. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who has given us little ones to increase our joy, and has promised to be not only our God, but also the God and Father of our children, keep, guard, and bless this child forevermore. As he has been baptized by our ministry into the Christian Church, so may he, by your guidance, become one with Christ. Grant that he may be a blessing to the home and the world into which he has been born. O God, our Father, give these to whom you have entrusted this child a wise, loving, devout, and faithful spirit. Guard them with your counsel. Guide them with your counsel as they teach and train him, and help them to raise him according to your ways. Empower them that they may serve the church with renewed devotion and steadfast loyalty. We commend to your loving parental care the children and families of this congregation. Help us in our homes to honor you and to serve one another in love. And to your name be all blessing and glory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Wesley will not remember this day, so tell him of it early and often. We give you this rose as a symbol of our love and commitment to you and to your child, and of our hope that in a world so often characterized by thorns, he will grow as a rose in its midst.
Welcome to the family of Christ.
And we give you this Bible and the certificate, and inside the Bible is his name inscribed, saying, we hope that he learns the ways of the Lord and walks in them all the way of his life. Welcome, Wesley. Aren't you handsome? So, Wesley, now that you're part of the church, we're going to take it from here. We got some work for you to do. There's some painting. There's some... I'm going to give them back to you, Dad. So here's what we're going to do. Dad and Mom, I'm going to have you stay here. Parents, you may be seated. And today is our first day of Sunday school, and we were going to bring the children all up to bless them on their way out. And I'm going to have Wesley be the center of that blessing as we come up. So kids, come on up. Come on up front, stand up here around with me. We're going to pray a prayer of blessing on you as we begin a new year of Sunday school. You're all very special to us and very special to Jesus. Jesus made time for kids because you were important and you're important to us. So come on up here. You can face me. You don't have to face the congregation. Face us up front. It is so good to have you here. Parents, Sunday school does start. Most of you, if you're new here today, fear not. There's signs downstairs. Forgive us for a little bit of the disruption downstairs because of the construction we're doing in the office space. But you'll see signs sending people where they need to go. It is good to have you guys here this morning. Congregation, would you join me in prayer as we bless these children this year? Dear God in heaven, thank you for these children, and thank you for all of the children who are part of this congregation here. We thank you for Wesley and for him being baptized and becoming a part of the community of faith. Lord, bless these children as they grow, all at different ages. Help them to grow physically strong, mentally strong, spiritually strong, Lord, that they may serve you. And anywhere you call them and whatever gifts you give them, may they learn to use them for your glory. Bless their studies and their schools during the week. Bless their time here in Sunday school. And bless their parents and their families. We pray all of this in the precious name of the one who loved children and said, "Let them come unto me," Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Kids, have a great time in Sunday school. Learn something. Wow your parents on the way home. Say, "Guess what I learned? Bet you didn't know this, Dad." You may go to Sunday school. Thank you to Joanne Peterson, who's coordinating everything, to our breakfast cooks, to our teachers, and to Mrs. Hamill, who is going to pick up with Children's Chapel again. Nice to have you. You're very welcome. Be sure to greet Sarah and Max and Wesley and the God Squad during coffee hour after church today. So today we will not share joys and concerns as we often do, just to keep things compressed a little bit. But there will be time to share joys and concerns afterwards. If I did have time to share things, I would tell you that Nancy Ferguson is doing well and in a rehab center. I would also tell you that Megan Rokicki asked me to wish your parents a happy anniversary. Happy anniversary, John and Marianne. We will have time to bring ourselves, to bring our loved ones and our concerns before the Lord this morning. I will give you time, as always, to speak things out loud. If you know the name of a person who needs prayer, when you're cued during the prayer, which will be obvious, you can speak that person's name out loud. God knows that person's situation. You're welcome to say a phrase with it, but you can do that. And if there's something going on in our world, you want to pray for our president, you want to pray for some issue, I mean, don't make a political statement, but you can neutrally lift the issue up before the Lord in our time of prayer. So we'll do that today. Let's come before our God during this time of prayer. God, you are present in all times and in all places. In fact, there's nowhere we can go where we're not in your presence. And yet, Lord, our minds, our hearts, ourselves, we're scattered. We're all over the place. Sometimes we're with you and sometimes we're not. So, Lord, as we begin our prayer this morning, we come before you. As our theme this morning is to reconnect and recommit, Lord, help us to reconnect to you everywhere, and may it begin here. Thank you for your love and your acceptance. Thank you for your grace. There's not one of us here who's perfect. We're all flawed. We're all sinful. We're all marred. And yet your grace and your love is sufficient. It accepts us. It embraces us. It forgives us. It transforms us. And so, Lord, we bring ourselves into your presence this morning. Grab hold of us, God. Reestablish the connection. Sync us up with you. Hear our prayers. We ask, Lord, that you not only be with us, but be with those who are on our hearts and minds this morning. We come thinking of people that are sick, people that are facing surgery, people that are facing trials in life of all sorts, Lord, and you know all things. So as we speak the names of our loved ones, continue to hear our prayers.
Nancy Ferguson, is that the one you're looking for? Anne.
Virginia.
God, hear the names of these people, and you know all things. We lift them before you, Lord. For those who are sick, we would pray for healing. For those who need provision, be it work or just to bail out of debt, Lord, help them and provide for their needs. For those who are discouraged, lift them up. For those who are addicted, set them free. For those who are facing difficult situations, give them wisdom. For those who are in broken relationships, bring healing and reconciliation as you have taught us so well. Lord, we lift these people along with ourselves to you. Hear our prayers, Lord, and be with each one according to their need. Lord, we pray for our church. We pray for this new year and ask you to be with us as Sunday school begins again. Be with us as confirmation class starts again this evening. Be with us as we continue to search for the assistant pastor that you have provided for us. And Lord, we are waiting, I guess we'll say patiently, but we're eager to show us that person, Lord, that they may join us in ministry and help us in the good work you're doing here. And Lord, be with all the various teams and the leadership council and all the things going on, Lord, and help us to collectively do your will. And may joy abound. May the work of the church and our community life not be a burden, but may we find renewed joy and life in its midst, Lord. And Father, be not only with us, but be with the wider body of Christ, for we are not the only ones who worship you. Bless our brothers and sisters throughout this town who gather together in different traditions, but in the name of Jesus Christ, to worship you. Bless those around this nation and this world, and thank you for this global movement of those who believe in your Son and follow in his ways. Father, be with us as a nation. Help us be with our president and our Congress and all of our officials. Help us, Lord. These seem to be very contentious times, Lord. I pray that you would keep us together as a people and help us, watch over us, Lord, as you always have. Forgive us that we've drifted from you, Lord, and bring us collectively as a people back to you to listen to solid and sound wisdom from you. We long for the day when peace will reign, when everything will be all right, Lord. That will be that day when you return, when your kingdom comes. Until then, Lord, help us to persevere. As the earth shakes and rumbles and various things happen, Lord, be with us in the meantime. We think especially of the people in the Bahamas, Lord, and the terrible devastation that Hurricane Dorian brought them, and others as well, Lord, but especially them this morning. Be with them as they rebuild. Be with those who mourn the loss of loved ones, Lord. Bring hope, bring the gospel in the midst of all the other recovery efforts going on there, Lord. Be with our wider community, Lord, as a new school year begins. Bless all the sports activities, Lord. Bless the education, bless the schools, the administrators, the teachers, Lord, and all that takes place there. Father, we give all these things to you, and we pray all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, choir. Nice to have you back after summer as well. Let us continue to worship our God as we hear from his word. You can turn your Bibles if you'd like, but also today, especially since the first three readings are short, I decided to put them up on the wall behind me. You can read along there as well. You'll see in just a moment, the title of my sermon is Foundation and Framework. And these first three passages that I'm going to read together are short. They all have to do with our foundation. and then the longer passage that Steve is going to read after me, which will also be on the wall, will be regarding our framework, and then I want to talk to you a little bit about that. So our first reading this morning comes from Matthew chapter 7, verse 24, the very end of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. Our second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 10 through 11. By the grace God has given me, I have laid a foundation as a wise builder, and someone else is building on it. But each one should build with care, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. Our third reading regarding foundations comes from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 19 through 22. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling place in which God lives by his Spirit. Here ends our first readings.
Our final reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 through 27. Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we are all baptized by one Spirit, so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, and we are all given the one Spirit to drink. And so the body is not made up of one part, but of many. Now if the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you, and the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and the parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with special honor, and the parts that are unpresentable, we treat with special modesty, while our presentable parts need no special treatment. But God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the parts that lacked it, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. Here ends our final reading.
So as I mentioned when we began worship this morning, by the way, it's just really good to see you all this morning, and welcome those of you who are visiting. It's just really nice to have you here today. I'm happy. I'm not always happy. I'm mostly happy. I want to speak for the next couple months on what it means to be the church. Whenever we sort of kick off a new year, and for those who are visiting and heard me kind of alluding to it, it's not officially the church year, but it's practically the church year. Church tends to run, especially here in New England, with the school year. We go full speed from September through June, take summers a little slow, and then we get back into speed. So whenever we come back up, I always want us to focus on what are our core values? Who are we? And what has God called us to do and be? So I want to focus on the church. And as I mentioned earlier, I want to focus on what is our foundation that we're being built on. And what is the framework? We're going to get into the details as the weeks go on. But what is the framework into which, or onto which, we're to build with God? So, first off,
The symbol of the church is a nice symbol, but it's not really the church, right? It's just the box that the parts go in. It's the toy box for the toys. It's the case for the phone, right? I don't know about you, but every time I get a new phone or a tablet or a device, I gotta have a case. And sometimes my wife will say, how many cases do you need? I say, well, I need a few different cases till I find the right one that works. Anybody relate to that, right? But the case isn't really what it's all about. I mean, it's the first thing you see, it's the shell that it's in, but it's not what it's all about. The phone is the valuable thing. The building, we're blessed here. We have this historic old building, 1789, on the front of the building, right here in the center of town. It has some value. It's a cool case. It's a great accessory, but that's really all it is. Because what really matters here are the people. We are a people. We are the body of Christ, and we are being built on a foundation. Now, there are all kinds of groups of people, and not everyone has the foundation that we have. There are all kinds of communities. And if you're not grounded anywhere, you float around, ungrounded and in space. I spent a lot of time in that graphic. You like that? Huh? But listen, I was watching a documentary week before last on Netflix on people who are losing their faith. Do you know what the largest growing religious demographic in the United States is? It's the nuns. No, not Catholic nuns. The N-O-N-E-S. Those who check off, what's your religious affiliation? None. In early 2000s, it was like 9%. Today, it's already up to like 22, 23% of Americans who say, I have no religious affiliation. I'm floating unanchored as a human being. And here's one thing that really surprised me in that documentary. There are people who no longer believe in God, but want a church-like experience. So there's this thing out there called Sunday Assembly. There's another group called the Oasis. And they basically do church without God. Imagine that, right? They say, well, we want to sing songs, and we want to hear messages that inspire us and tell us to live. We want to be in community and share food together and share our lives together. We just don't want anything to do with God or the supernatural. When I read that, I thought, oh, have you ever been to a congregational church? Sadly enough, that is a big trend in our own mainline American movements, where we've forgotten our foundation and we've begun to drift. And we're a community of people that, yes, we believe we should care for one another, we should do good in the world, we should try to do good things and all this kind of stuff, but we've forgotten our foundation, and yes, we begin to drift like we're in outer space, not knowing who we are or whose we are. My friends, that is not who we are to be. We are being built on a foundation. Let's talk about that foundation. What is that foundation? The foundation, my friends, is the Word of God. The Word of God. And that was so impactful, but now I got to click another thing here. Built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. We say in our bylaws that Jesus Christ is the head of this church, and that the Bible is a sufficient rule for life and living. This, my friend, is our foundation. Now, I know what some people say. You're stuck in the past. You're stuck in ancient writings, and you need to get up with the times. You know, I agree, right? We're stuck in the past. 1789, the Constitution of the United States. It's old. It's outdated. Throw it away, right? America say, no. Why? That's so old. I mean, 1700s? Come on, people. No, we hold on to that Constitution because it has the principles of our founding fathers that guides our nation. I'm saying there's greater principles. There's a greater founding document here that not only guides our nation, but guides the nations. It shows us how we got here. It shows us why we're here and how we're to live and how we're to relate to our God and our world and one another. It is foundational. The Church of Jesus Christ is built on the apostles, the prophets, and Jesus Christ, who are taught to us from here. This is where we hear the prophets. This is where we hear the writings and teachings of the apostles. That phrase right there is a teaching from the Apostle Paul from Ephesians. This is where we hear the words of Christ. This is our foundation, but hear me well. Our foundation is our foundation, and it's not as if we're obsessed or idolizing an old book, but this book guides us to know the living God, to have a relationship with the living God and the living Holy Spirit through the living and risen Savior who is Jesus Christ. So it's old, but it's foundational. I don't know how you feel about this. It's probably because it's my job and calling. I find this kind of cool. I don't know why I keep thinking of this, but I think of the movies National Treasure. Have you seen those, you know? And there's like this treasure from way back, and they're trying to find it. And when they find it, it's going to be full of wealth and riches and maybe wisdom. And a lot of movies have this, right? Science fiction and fantasies, where there's like this treasure. There's this power source. There's this source of life and wealth and riches. This is it. And church, we are keepers of this ancient truth, of this founding document. And we are to learn it, and we are to study it, and we are to digest it, and we are to know it, and we are to let it guide us into all truth and all life. This, my friends, is our foundation. And on this foundation, Christ is building his church. His church, again, which is not a building. Jesus never had a building program. The early church never built buildings. They met in homes, met in the synagogues or the temple courts, places that were around, because they weren't really about buildings. They were about being a community of people. And so Christ is building the body of Christ upon the foundation of his word. So let's talk for a minute about this framework. You are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. Now, let me be honest. Not everyone is a part of the body of Christ. I'm not going to assume that everyone here this morning is a part of the body of Christ. You need to come into the body of Christ. How does one do that? It's not hard, but not everyone does it for sure. Those who are checking none off on their list of religious affiliations obviously aren't coming in. You become a part of the body of Christ by hearing the message of Christ and by believing in your heart and confessing with your mouth. Romans tells us that whoever believes in their heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and that he rose from the dead and confesses with their mouth shall be saved. So if you haven't done that this morning, continue to listen, because this is interesting and maybe you want in. And I encourage you to. That's obviously my hope and prayer. But I'm not going to assume, and nor should you assume, that you're automatically part of the body of Christ. You need to come in. The invitation is there for every single one of you. And search your own heart. You may have been coming to church for whatever reason. Maybe your spouse dragged you here, your kids dragged you here, and you've never made a decision to put your faith in Jesus Christ and become a part. I encourage you to do that today. Now, to the rest of you who are already a part, you are a part of the body of Christ. Each one of you a part. Someone might say, oh, but wait a minute, I didn't sign up for that membership. I signed up for the body of Christ, the individual plan, where it's just about me, because I like my faith in Christ, I like my prayer time, I like him being with me, but I'm not really into the community thing. I don't really want to be a part of everybody else. Too bad. You're either in or you're out. If you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are a part of the body of Christ. Now, you can use your gifts and you can contribute to the work of Christ, or you can be like a bum leg that the rest of the body of Christ is dragging along because you're a part, but you're not doing your work. But you are a part. There's no other way around it. There's no way to be a Christian and not be a part of the body of Christ in some way. I love what was read this morning in Corinthians, and that's kind of the summarizing verse that you're all a part, but that whole idea of your body, right? You have eyes, you have ears, you have a mouth, you have hands and feet and knees, you have a buttocks and an appendix and all these kind of things, and they all serve a purpose. Some are glamorous, some are a little, you keep them clothes on, right? And other things are very helpful and essential, and other things don't seem so much, but they all work together in your body, and you need it all. I love the body. In fact, in all honesty, the body is the biggest testimony to me that there is a Creator God, if that's where you are and you're wrestling now. It's so beautifully complex, and it's so interdependent. My nervous system, and my respiratory system, and my circulatory system, and my digestive system, and my muscular system, they all work in harmony with one another. Even right now, to move my hands, look at that, isn't that kind of cool what I'm doing here? To move my hands, and to move my mouth, and so I can see, and we're all work together. My friends, in the body of Christ, and I'm going to be talking to you a lot about this, those who are with us regularly over the next couple months, God has brought us together. We are part of a community of people, First Congregational Church of Holden. And it's not just us, by the way, it's the whole thing, but let's not worry about out there right now, let's worry about us. We are called to be a community, and you have a part of it. What is your gift? What is your part? We read, yes, are you the eyes? Maybe you're the heart that just breaks for people. Maybe you're the hands that just loves to serve. Maybe you're the feet that goes out and helps people. Maybe you're the brains, you're an administrator. Maybe you're a singer, maybe you're a speaker. There's all kinds, maybe you're a giver. We're gonna talk about all those different things over the next couple months. But if you are a Christian, Jesus has made you a part of his body. You can be dead weight, you can be kind of undeveloped and sitting there, or you can be a part and learn to be a part of who God has called you to be. Now, within the body of Christ, there needs to be two things I'm just going to share with you. There needs to be grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. We are so imperfect, but we live by God's grace. So as you look around, you may be the eyes of Christ, but your eyes don't have 20/20 vision, and you have a wandering eye that gets distracted by this and that, but you are the eyes, but you're imperfect. You may be the legs of Christ, but you've got bum knees, so you don't get around very well. You may be the hands, but you've got arthritis. You may be the ears, but one ear doesn't hear very well. We are all imperfect in the body of Christ. And while we each have our part, no one does their part perfectly because we're all imperfect. So the grace that Christ has given us to bring us into his body, we need to give to one another. We need to encourage one another and build one another up and say, you know what, we need people to start walking better. We need people to start seeing more clearly and listening more intently. And we may be so imperfect at that, but we're going to give each other some grace, because in that grace and that love, we can support and encourage and actually become the people God wants us to be. And then the other thing is, by the way, 1 Corinthians 12:27, do you know what happens in 1 Corinthians right after that? He talks about being the body. He talks about all the parts. And then at the very end of 12, you know what Paul says? And now I'm going to show you the most excellent way. And then he goes into that beautiful chapter, 1 Corinthians 13. What's the most excellent way? It's the way of love. Love binds us all together. We are called to be the body of Christ. We are so imperfect. If you come from a perfect church, you don't. Nobody does, if you're visiting today. And if you I always say, if you find a perfect church, don't join it, you'll ruin it. We're not perfect. Nobody's perfect, so we give each other grace, and we love each other. We pull together. You know, oh, you're supposed to be the legs, but your knee is really bothering you. Let me help you. I've got strong arms. I can carry you while your legs aren't working well. You're not seeing well. Maybe I can be your eyes. It's not really my gift, but I'll do it. We love one another. We care for one another. We support one another. My friends, there is nothing greater than love. For God so loved the world that he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to love us and forgive us and invite us to be part of his body and his community. And he has said, here's my command that I tell you. You are to love one another like I love you. And he said, the world will know that you are my disciples, that you are my body, if you love one another. So I love the fact that when people come to our church, they say, your people are loving and they're accepting. And I love that, because that is the biggest testimony to me that Christ is working in our midst. We are the body of Christ, built on the foundation of the Word of God. It will instruct us. All the things I've said to you this morning are coming from God's Word. Check it and see. That's what you should do. We're the body of Christ, built on the foundation of the apostles, the prophets, with Christ Himself. We are to be together as a community. Figure that out. We are to love one another and show grace so that we can do the work of God in this world. This is what the church is. There's that nice case again. It's kind of nice bling, isn't it? It's a nice case, historic case. This is the framework and foundation. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for your word, the message of Christ, Lord. We cherish it, Lord, and we hold it humbly. Like all humans, we are so prone to stray. We are so prone to go off and truly float in space. Lord, keep us grounded in your word, as individuals and as a church. And Lord, gather your body. You've saved us. You've called us to be together. And now, Lord, show us how to be that community. Show us how to show grace and love and to each one do their part so that we can be about your work, Jesus. So that we can be your hands and your feet. And we can bring you glory. And we can carry on your ministry to seek and save the lost and to share the love of God to the entire world. Lord, bless this little church. I pray for those today who are toying whether they should come in or stay outside of the body of Christ. I pray they would feel compelled to come in and live in great community with you and others and in grace. And I pray for those who are in that you would sharpen us and pull us together, Lord, for your glory. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
We have an obligation to proclaim the gospel. We are entrusted with a commission, so we give freely of our time and our abilities where we are, and we send and support the witness of others where we cannot go. Let us continue to give generously. The morning offering will now be received.
Let us pray. Dear God, you have blessed us abundantly. You are the one who gives us the ability to make wealth. So Lord, receive these offerings that we give before you this day. They are first and foremost an offering of thanksgiving to you for blessing us so much. And use them, Lord, to strengthen the ministry of your church in this place, to help those in need and to spread the gospel across the street and to the ends of the earth until you come again in all your glory. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Sisters, how good it has been to worship together this morning, to be together. I hope you can stay for a little bit. We will have coffee hour downstairs. By the way, coffee hour is back in again. And yes, the same old message rings out. We could use your help. Correct? Helping out with coffee hour and making it happen. So, but please stay today. A little fellowship, a chance to say hello to Wesley and his family and friends, and a chance to catch up with one another. As you leave this place, wherever God leads you, may He truly lead you. May His Spirit fill you and guide you and give you wisdom and strength to be the people He's called you to be. May His light light the path before you and open and close doors so that you will live a life full of grace, full of richness, and full of blessing. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Amen.